This week's episode of the Disney Nerds Podcast is brought to you by Kingdom Strollers. Kingdom Strollers rents premium strollers in the Orlando area. Whether it be a single, double, or special needs, they can help you out. Kingdom Strollers is also Disney approved, which means they can deliver directly to your hotel and pick it up when you're done. The next time you're headed to the Orlando area, don't pay extra to fly with your stroller. Save that room in your trunk for those extra pair of tennis shoes you'll know you'll need. Contact our friends over at Kingdom Strollers at www.kingdomstrollers.com.
Welcome to the splendor, the spectacle, the sparkling sensation, where the romance, the comedy, and the thrill of Disney fantasies come to electric life.
And as our friend Jiminy said, welcome to the Disney Nerds Podcast. A place each week where like-minded people get together to discuss all things Disney. We'll help you get your Disney fix on. Here we go.
The Magic Kingdom proudly presents, in a million points of musical light, the magical worlds of Disney.
Welcome aboard, Islanders. You are on the Disney Skyliner at Disney's Caribbean Beach Resort. We're flying to Disney's Riviera Resort with continuing flights to Epcot.
That's the Riviera.
Hold on to your straw hats. We are about to enter the heart of the Caribbean. We are now sailing over Disney's Caribbean Beach Resort, home to a collection of tropical villages inspired by the colorful architecture and lifestyle of the Caribbean islands.
Hello and welcome to show number 310 of the Disney Nerds Podcast. Hey guys, how's it going? And welcome back to the show. On this week's show, it's all about the Skyliner. So before we get into that topic, let me introduce who we have with us. First off, we have Lisa. Hey, Lisa, how's it going?
Hey, Ed. How are you doing tonight?
I'm doing good. Doing good. I want to get into this topic. Along with us, we also have Sam. Hey, Sam.
Ed, what is up? It's all about the Skyliner? Oh, my gosh. There's so much to talk about that we didn't expect to be talking about. Wow.
Oh, I know. And let's dive right into it. Now, we're not going to do much of the intro stuff we normally do on the show because we want to start talking about this and kind of get this topic out there. Tonight's show is basically going to be talking to Lisa because she's ridden on the Skyliner a couple of times, and we wanted to hear what she had to say about it. However, this past weekend, we had that little bit of an accident going on over at the, where did it happen? I think it was at the Riviera.
It happened at the Riviera.
Yeah, and a couple cars got jacked up and kind of crashed together, and people were out there for, I think, 3 hours. And, yeah. So
it wasn't a good day. It wasn't a good day, for sure.
And it's a shame. It was open for 6 days, and yeah. Then they had that one issue. But, you know, we'll start going into it. First off, I just want to kind of talk about the Skyliner. And for those that don't know, and just to bring you up to speed, just in case, Disney opened up their Skyliner gondola system on, when was it, September 29th, I believe it was?
September 29th.
And Lisa was lucky enough to be there for the opening day of it and got to experience it fully. Now, we had seen that weeks before. They were doing cast member previews, so we saw a lot of that also. And for about 6 months before that, the Skyliners have been running in test mode.
We have been watching these things for it feels like 2 years, Ed. Them putting the poles in and running cables and getting the updates every time we went down to Walt Disney World to go stand next to the things and take pictures and where's it going. And it's been incredible to watch this whole thing.
I know. We've all have our stories based on it. Remember, I think it was last November, we got lost. My bus could not get to our hotel because they were stringing cable across the area.
You were staying at Pop, right?
Right, yep. And she just couldn't get back. And it took us about a half hour to kind of roam around property till we finally got back to our hotel.
It's the latest Disney transportation center, complete with merchandise. And it's pretty impressive when you sit back and look at it.
I think no Disney launch is complete unless it has its own merchandise. And some of the merchandise is really cool.
It is cool.
It is cool, but it is a transportation system first and foremost. So
yes, it is.
I think Disney is.
Is it though, Ed? Is it?
No, it's not.
I asked that because I have said clearly since day one, and this is because I stayed at the Contemporary, my first trip, that my favorite attraction of all time is the monorail. So it's a mode of transportation, but could you also potentially call it an attraction?
Oh, sure. Oh, no doubt. And I tell you, the videos we've seen from it prove it pretty much like manyfold.
So let's compare it for a second, because you can see it and it's there and it's obvious and you have the characters all over it. But at the end of the day, it's a system to get you from Epcot's International Gateway to Hollywood Studios and some resorts in between, which is exactly what the friendship boats do. But do you put those in the same light? Right. I go to Disney World. I have to ride the monorail. I think that I go to Disney World now. I need to ride the Skyliner when it's up and running. Do I need to ride the friendship boats? No, it's transportation. So it's interesting that the thing up in the air, right?
So that kind of says a little bit there. I've never ridden the friendship boats between the two studios or Epcot or to the hotels over there. I've never had the need to.
So it's an interesting question. My answer is yes. So yeah. And that's how I look at things. So my trip is never complete unless I have ridden the monorail. Mm-hmm. Unless I've taken the big ferry launch, mm-hmm. unless I have taken the small boats in between the Grand Floridian and the Poly and Magic Kingdom.
Oh, wow. See, I don't know that I can get all those in.
Unless I've taken the bus.
It's kind of depending on the trip itself on each trip, but there are some definite things we try to do.
And depending where you're staying, right? Sure. If you're at the Epcot resorts, I mean, the friendship boats are how you get to Epcot and Hollywood Studios. And likewise, now if you're staying at the Caribbean Beach or Pop Century or Art of Animation or the Riviera, the Skyliner is how you get to Epcot and Hollywood Studios. Or that's your transportation. There are no buses. Well, there are, but there aren't. You know what I mean?
And that is always one of the hardest things, is to get from park to park. I mean, we can get from Magic Kingdom to Epcot by monorail. But getting from, say, like Hollywood Studios to the Magic Kingdom was always a pain in the butt, or Epcot and things like that. So this was going to help that out. But I do see the point of it being more of an attraction, too, because, and again, based on the videos, but Lisa's going to fill us in now, it looked like it was basically a kind of an excitement type of attraction where you're going fast, you're going high, and you're moving along. But anyway, Lisa, you were there the first day. Tell us what that was like.
I was. So this is the funny thing. So we're talking September 29th, which was a Sunday morning. Hmm. On Friday night, I was at Hollywood Studios. And I walked over to the Skyliner, and there was a very nice cast member there. And I said, so. And she looked at me like she had been asked a question about 470 million times. She said, 6:45 on Sunday morning. And I said, okay. I said, but I'm going to ask the other question. And she said, okay. I said, are you guys going to soft open tomorrow? Because that's the Disney way.
Sure it is. Mm-hmm.
You soft open. And she looked at me and said, no. And I went, well, I appreciate your candidness and your honesty. Yeah. And she was right. They didn't soft open the day before, which to me, looking back, might have told me something probably. But moving forward 2 days, Sunday morning, I set my alarm clock for 6 a.m. I was in the parking lot at Studios, parked in the first row. And I had pulled in, and the person at the gate said, are you a hotel guest? Because Studios opens at 6 a.m.
Extra magic hours.
Oh, that's right.
Extra magic hours for Galaxy's Edge.
Yep.
And I said, no, I'm not. She's like, you're not going to be able to get into the parks. I said, I'm here for the Skyliner. And she went, well, that's a first for me today.
Love it.
So I said, well, it won't be the only first. I said, my wife's behind me, so she's going to tell you the same thing. Because I couldn't do it without Angela, and Angela had to work. So she was
going straight from there to work.
Oh, cool.
So we ended up parking in the first row on that Sunday morning, walking around and walking right onto the Skyliner.
That's awesome, Lisa. That is just awesome.
It was, and I'll take your concerns and your questions and whatever. I don't think words can put into play how amazing it was. It was pretty awesome. And there were things that I didn't notice. So at 6:45 in the morning, we were able to walk right on. I was able to kind of choose the car I wanted. And for my first trip, I had been told that I should choose one that doesn't have a ramp. It's easier to see out of.
I did hear that. Okay.
Choose one. Say that again. One that does not have a ramp?
Has a ramp.
A ramp.
Has the art. Has the artwork on it.
The characters on it. I understand.
You can see out of it better.
So you're not looking through the little holes that are in it, right? Because that when you sit on a bus, you get
it. A thick screen.
Yes. It's like looking through a screen. Fair enough. I get it.
Fair enough.
Now, just to be honest, if you're looking through the thick screen, that's fine. But to the right and to the left is clear.
Cool.
So it's not a thick screen all the way around. It's just on the front and the back. But to the right and to the left, you can see through.
Right.
We took the Skyliner line from Hollywood Studios to Caribbean Beach, where I learned my first rule in Skyliner etiquette. Which is, they wouldn't let me stay on. I just want to go back to Hollywood Studios. They said, you got to get off.
And this is at Caribbean Beach.
Which is the main hub. It's where they park all of them. It's I don't want to call it a barn because it's not inside, but there's row after row after row where they park these things every night.
So similar to the monorail barn up in the Magic Kingdom.
Yeah, very similar.
Mm-hmm.
With that being said, this station was gorgeous. It looks like Times Square. It looks like, Square, maybe Union
Grand Square? Central Station.
Grand Central Station. There's a big clock in the center. It's very well themed. The signing is great. So you get off the Hollywood Studios Skyliner and it brings you right into the center. There's a line to the left and a line to the right. And then the return to get back onto Hollywood Studios, which would be behind you. You just kind of go right around in a circle. The line to the left is your Epcot line. The line to the right takes you to Pop and Art. And on that particular morning, now we're coming up on 7 o'clock, 7:05-ish. It's the only line that was open was the Art and Pop.
Okay.
So there were people potentially leaving Art of Animation or Pop Century to go to Hollywood Studios for those extra magic hours, and they had to connect through the Caribbean Beach.
Correct. That Epcot line did not open until 8 a.m.
So they were conscious enough to know that nothing's going on until that time in the morning, so there's no reason to have tourists going up that way.
Correct.
Which is great.
And I'd say until the Riviera opens, that could change because I think there'll be some character dining things going on up there. But that's still cool. And that station, Lisa, that's the biggest of them, and it's the only station where there are three lines that come together.
That's right. All three lines come into that station. We did that morning, then go on to Art of Animation and Pop Century, get off and go around. Now, this the Art and Pop line, if you're unfamiliar with where that station is, it's also cleverly themed. It is a floating station out in the center of Hourglass Lake.
Oh, I did hear that.
Which is really cool. We then got back on that, went back to Caribbean Beach, went back to Hollywood Studios, and that was when I decided I've enjoyed both of these lines. I've watched the sunrise. Now it's time to share it with the Disney nerds, and that was when I went live that morning.
That's cool. So you watch the sunrise from one of the gondolas. That's pretty cool.
And if you time it right, I would tell you that you could probably see a couple sets of fireworks.
Oh, yeah, sure. That's a great thing to plan for. What kind of heights are we talking about? Do they vary how high you off on the high you are off the ground?
Yep. Some sets are higher than others. When you go up and when you come down, even some pole to pole, some of them are a little bit higher than others. Some of them are lower than others. I don't know the exact heights at the moment. But I will tell you, and we talked about it a little bit ago, and I talked about it when I did the live stream. So when you're taking off out of the station, it has some giddy up to it.
Nice.
And when you're coming into the station, it has the equal amount of giddy up to it.
So it has the equal amount of speed coming in, which I think I'd heard was 16 or 17 miles per hour, depending on where they have it.
Feels like it's about 100, Sam.
Okay. And then it changes from the cable that's moving really fast to a slower cable as it comes through the system.
Yep.
Is that what happens?
Yeah, it catches, and it's almost like, I'm trying to think if there's an attraction out there I can think of that has that moment where you kind of get caught up in it, and it almost swings a little bit on you, like you've stopped and you're going forward. Oh. And
it's like a shock absorber grabs you at the end of it, and you're kind of inertiaing it yourself.
Like a zip line.
Yeah, right. That's exactly what it looks like when you're coming down to it. And I've seen a bunch of videos of the cars coming in and out of the station, and yeah, that is a pretty intense speed. Even to the point where you start stacking up with the other ones going around in the station, you're getting very close very fast.
Yeah.
When you are facing forward, because you can sit either facing where you've come from or facing where you're going to. When you're facing forward, even still, and I rode this last week, when we came into the station, I put my foot up on the chair in front of me.
Like, oh, okay, sure.
There's a little anxiety that comes along with how, how hot that comes into the station.
Right.
That may be changing.
And you mentioned something else that brings up a big point that a lot of people have talked about. You mentioned hot. How was the temperature inside the cars?
Oh, yeah.
So interesting.
And how was the weather, I guess, around it too on the outside?
Yeah. So I've ridden this twice in the morning when I was riding it, and we rode it from 6:45 in the morning until probably 9-ish. Mm-hmm. Yeah, were those people? So
there's nothing wrong with that.
I have a whole morning planned for the Skyliner if it's open again. Go ahead.
6:45 in the morning till about 9-ish, and it was chilly. I wish I'd brought a sweatshirt.
Nice.
But and the morning. Temperature outside, it was a little humid, but might have been 74 at that point, but it was chilly.
Mm-hmm.
In Skyliner, because the breeze, there's definitely some air moving around in that cabin.
Air circulation.
Now, go ahead.
With that being said, the second time I rode it at noon.
Okay, now true I want to hear it.
Equally as chilly.
Okay,
nice.
Now, equally, I had zero concern about the temperature in the moving compartment. Now, I just talked about there's two rows of seats inside, one where you're facing forward, the other one where you're facing backwards. If you have concerns about being hot and you get into the Skyliner, sit on the seats to the right so that you're facing forward. Those seats are colder than the ones on the left. You get the breeze because it's the forward-moving fins that blow the breeze on you.
Got it. Okay.
So it's like a direct blast of cool air.
Right. Good to know. Some of the videos I saw, the cars had slowed down or actually stopped for a minute or two, and that's when the people started reporting it started to get a little warm. Did you guys have any of that?
So I experienced about a 20-minute delay.
Oh, okay. That's kind of substantial. I'm surprised we didn't hear about that. I'm sorry you missed it if you said that.
I experienced about a 20-minute delay on the Epcot line. But I was at the Riviera Resort, and the door was open. It was also first thing in the morning, so I can't be the judge of that. I can't tell you how hot it got or how hot it didn't get inside based on the difference between, 2 in the afternoon, 9 at night, 7 in the morning. I'm certain it's significantly different, and I'm not about to make that judgment.
Right. Now, we did find out a lot of information about the Skyliner, which we didn't know beforehand, based on the accident they had on Saturday. we did know, of course, that they had invented different ways to get people off the Skyliner. And even though some of the reporting showed zip lining, they didn't actually do any zip lining on this issue. They did, however, do some of the trucks with the, I guess, cherry pickers mounted on top of them. Better way to explain it, I'm sure there's out there, but that's how it looks, where they could bring them up to the level of the gondolas and get people out that way.
Bucket trucks.
Yeah, okay, very good. But the majority of them, I understand, basically once they cleared that car that was holding up the line that caused the accident off the line into that little holding area, I guess, inside the station, they were able to start the Epcot line back up again, and they slowly started moving people off. When I was watching the Orlando news report, while they were talking to the guy in the news, it was they were already reported how they started to move them again, and they were starting to go slowly to the station.
What time that was, because I was out at the time of the accident. I was on property when it happened.
Oh, gotcha. Now, I tell you what, it was on the news report, and it was at the start of the news report, so they had the time at about 11:03. So
that makes sense.
Right, okay. And I saw different reports of people in the some of the parking lots calling up to the people in the gondolas and such like that. One of the things we found out was each of the gondolas has an emergency storage compartment that has emergency supplies in it. From what we understand and heard, they have water in there. They have air sickness bags, go figure. And they had light sticks. I haven't heard anything more than that. Have you guys?
A pen and a notepad?
Oh, I did hear that. And Leslie and I were wondering, like, why do you have that? What are you going to do, like, write your last message? Or what are you expecting to have happen? We couldn't figure out why you would have that in there.
I don't know.
That was a strange one. I didn't get
it
that.
It is
one.
Interesting. The interesting, too, it was bags of water.
Yes.
Bags? What do you mean?
A bag of water. Think of a...
Like a sippy bag?
Not a Ziploc bag, no, but an emergency water. But it wasn't a bottle of water. It was a bag of water. Think of those ice packs that you'd smash and they turn into ice. It kind of looked like that. You rip off the corner and it's water inside.
Oh, wow. That's more of a souvenir in my nerd mind, actually, at this point.
I'd more so assume that a pen and a piece of paper would be something that I would use to distract my kids.
Yeah,
fair enough.
Play a game, play tic-tac-toe, write a story, draw a picture.
Anything.
Okay.
Yeah, and, you know, 3 hours is an awful long time to be in those things. And
drop notes to people on the ground.
Yeah, that's a long time. And I guess what we talked before, and I mentioned it comes in hot, and then it changes to a separate line, and that line goes slower. Clearly something happened at the exchange from where it goes fast to where it slows down. That's where the issue started. I don't know that someday we may know exactly what happened, but that's clearly where the situation occurred and caused some other cars to back up.
So we talked about this briefly on our Tuesday Night Live show, very briefly, but I did get a question and I want to kind of share it with our podcast listeners. One of the questions I got was, when it comes into the station and it slows down, and it does slow down very significantly, you can walk on. There is not a moving platform. So there is not something that's going at the same pace as the Skyliner. You do have to walk and step onto the moving Skyliner.
Mm-hmm.
If you don't feel comfortable doing that, and I saw this happen with my own eyes, if there is somebody that doesn't feel comfortable stepping onto the moving gondola, they can go into there's a handicap line that has two cars that are off the track.
Mm-hmm.
That you can load stationary.
The secondary line, sort of like Toy Story Mania. They pull a car off to load handicap and then push it back in.
Okay. We've been predicting that one for a while. That had to be just because there are, you know, it's going to be issues like that. And that's how it was in the old Skyway system they had in the Magic Kingdom, where you had to, you know, of course, walk into it like you normally would. And that was like 30 years ago, 20 years ago. And that thing would stop all the time because people would miss it. And if you had videos back then watching that ride, you would probably get a hell of a hit reel of people just like missing it and like falling and stuff like that. It just happened all the time. It was one of those natural things that everybody took for granted. It's going to happen. The same with ski lifts at, you know, ski resorts and things like that. There's always somebody that's going to miss it.
So let's talk a little bit about the line that had the issue on Saturday night, and that's the Epcot line.
The Epcot 2 Riviera Resort line. The longest line, from what I understand.
The Epcot 2, the Riviera to the Caribbean. It's all one line.
Okay.
It pivots. It's all one line.
Okay. So when you come through the Riviera then, there'd be no – can they still take one of the cars off for handicap, or does it just flow right through slowly?
I think the Riviera is still just a normal station just like that, and you just don't have to get off there. That's the only difference between
that's
that
the and only the difference. It's its own station.
Okay.
But it's still the same line, and you can pull one off to the side.
Okay. Cool.
Yeah, so with that being said, it's still the same line. So we've been hearing a lot of, the Skyliner's broken down for 45 minutes here or 20 minutes here, like in my case, or 3 hours in the case of Saturday night with that incident that happened. But I haven't heard any complaints or any issues with the Art Pop line or the Hollywood Studios to Caribbean line.
Yeah.
And that right. being said, the Epcot line has two huge turn points.
Sure.
Huge turn points. And I think, I want to say I think, I don't think, I know that that is what is causing the chaos.
Because these things slow down when they enter those turns, right?
Yes.
So there's another pass off from a fast cable to a slower cable?
Yes.
Okay. I understand. I'm starting to get the picture here.
So at both the turn point at the boardwalk and the station at the Riviera. So when you think about it, you've got one line typically has a turn, a switch off at the beginning and a switch off at the end. That's two turn points. This one has a switch off at the beginning, a switch off at the end, and then two in the middle. That's four. That's two times the amount of chances for something to potentially go wrong. And that's
which are, yeah, okay.
That's where you're having the problems. As somebody would say, oh, I don't like the fly because it's scary. Well, really, it's only about the takeoff and the landing.
Right.
Right.
We're doubling the chance of something happening there.
Well, we're hoping that they figure out what's going on. The official statement was something along the lines of, well, we're trying to do everything we can to figure out what happened. We made sure everybody was okay. I heard the message they left at the resort to let everybody know that the Skyliner was down and it's not going to be operating that following, I guess it was going to be a Sunday, and then it was just closed after that.
When you say heard the message, like heard the recording that they sent, or what did
correct.
You hear?
Yeah, somebody had it on YouTube. So they okay. recorded it as he heard it on the
so it was a voicemail that correct. Hit the rooms. Yep. So if you're staying at, because they're all, none of them are running right now. So clearly if you were staying at Art of Animation and expected to get to studios, guess what? You're going to need to get a bus in the morning because that gondola that you expected to go to isn't going to be working.
Right. Correct. Which brings up a whole line of questions like, well, do people get refunds because they stayed specifically at those resorts for the Skyliner's convenience and stuff like that?
And they were handling those people's those people's concerns individually. I will say, you say that it's not running. Right now it's not running with people on it.
Fair enough.
It is running. That's what I heard, too. It's been running for the past, I think, 2 days now, where that's a good sign. Initially, there is the thinking that it could have been perhaps the grabbing devices that grabbed the lines on each of the gondolas, which meant that they, if that was the issue, they might have had to replace all of them.
That would have taken a while.
The one thing I will tell you from somebody who's been driving under them for a little bit, and you'd even notice it too, Sam and Ed, I don't know whether or not you've seen them in motion yet, but they're running at a significantly slower speed.
Got it.
Well, they did say there's some type of mode. It's a reset mode that they do smaller, and that's what got everybody back into the station, I guess, to unload them Saturday. I'm sure there's various different modes for this thing.
But at least if you're talking about, you know, putting your foot up because you were coming in there hot, you may have experienced something that we never get to experience because they could slow these things down.
Sure. And that's going to be kind of the thing they weigh out, because a lot of the people were saying they thought it was definitely faster than the buses getting to the different locations they were getting to. However, yeah, if you slow it down, that's going to kind of hit on that. And I definitely think the views are worth the ride, even if they slow it down. But again, you're going to be putting aside some extra time to do this.
The views are phenomenal. And something that I learned as I was up on the Skyliner is that there are a lot of non-Disney hotels very close to Disney property.
Oh, yeah, there are. Sure.
Oh, my gosh.
Way more than what you'd know, what you'd think about if you were on the ground. And I spent a lot of time going, what is it? Oh, maybe. What is that? That's not. And it, you know, it dawns on me that it's not even something that's on Disney property.
Right.
Oh, sure. Some of my favorite hotels down on what's the strip? The I-4 strip or
Hotel Boulevard?
The Beltway? Yep. Are literally only about like a quarter mile from the most southern all-star resort on Disney property. If you look at an overhead map, all you have is like a little bit of a swamp.
It's not that far.
You have the major road near there.
I was just driving down Western Way Tuesday, and I got on 429. They've extended Western Way all the way to 27, but I got onto 429, and I didn't realize that there's a townhome suites right there, right on the right at the edge of Disney property.
Oh, sure.
Is that one of the new ones? Is that Flamingo Crossing?
Yep.
So Flamingo Crossing, there's a townhome suite, there's a Fairfield, there's a Marriott Village of sorts coming in there. That's the with the practice facilities right there. So that may be on property, that new Flamingo Crossing.
This is different. This is different.
Okay.
Yeah, it must not be that. This is over by Coronado. You get on Western Way.
Oh, yes. And right around, I know where you mean.
Right around the corner, you leave Disney property.
Yeah, where there's a Dunkin' Donuts pretty darn close there.
Okay.
That I might have visited because somebody told me it was there.
You know what? There's another question I had gondola-wise. At the stations, are there restrooms? Or are they just kind of barren stations like you're at a parking lot type of station?
No, restrooms. I think there's a Joffrey's coffee at every single station.
Oh, okay. So it's kind of like civilized, I guess, station-wise.
Yeah, is it civilized? I think it's kind of cool because I'm staying at Art of Animation, and I want to get to studios as early as I can. And you know what? I'm going to grab my coffee and my pastry at the gondola and eat it on the way.
Yeah,
I love it.
Or else I was thinking more like if I'm going to Epcot and I get to Riviera, I might have to stop at the Riviera just in case. I get stuck for 3 hours.
Well, if you get stuck for 3 hours, you might need that bag for something besides water.
Well, that's what I was wondering is, like, they have to add that to the list of things they have in the emergency supply cabinet is something for, like, a half-gallon jug, an empty jug.
After all that, Sam, I stand corrected. You're absolutely talking about Flamingo Crossing, and I am talking about it, too.
Okay, there you go.
Correct. That's exactly right. And you are not on property over there.
Okay. I knew it was close, but that was Disney's, you know, and we're kind of seeing everything play out that they've been talking about. Flamingo Crossing is Disney trying to get some of those sports teams that tend to stay in the All-Stars and get them in a place where they have a practice facility right outside of their hotel. So if they're taking that serious, they can quickly get over to Wide World of Sports and they're in that general area and it frees up the All-Stars for guests that are hitting the parks every day.
Correct.
That's interesting. That's kind of cool. I have a non-gondola related question, but it's related. If you show 6 a.m. on Sunday morning, extra magic hour starts at 6. You parked front and center. How was the parking lot? Were there people there headed in the studios at 6 o'clock in the morning?
Very few.
Now I tell you what. For our trip coming up, they stop it on November 1st is the last extra hours. Yes, I was double checking that.
Guys, you don't need it.
Yeah,
well,
that's what I'm
I was going to say, if it was popular, I bet Disney extends it. If they're selling out the lightsaber things and the droid depot and all that, they would have continued to do extra magic hours, no problem.
Right, but now you can walk into Oga's.
Wow.
Yeah.
Into the cantina.
Yeah.
I happen to see, I was looking at around 6 o'clock this evening. It's a Friday night we're recording this week. And 6 o'clock at night, the Millennium Falcon ride was a 25-minute wait. The Slinky Dog roller coaster was 80 minutes. So
there you go.
That tells a lot. That tells a lot. All the other rides around the property were about their regular time, 130 for the Flight of Passage, standard 80 for Seven Dwarfs. I mean, everybody was at the regular ride times other than, or the wait times, other than
Here we are on a Friday night. Last week on Saturday night, we went to Animal Kingdom. And we did Flight of Passage.
Okay.
When I walked up, and this is my message to, I said it on Tuesday night on the live show, and I'll say it here. We walked up. It was a 125-minute wait. My mother really wanted to do Flight of Passage, and my niece had never done it.
Okay. So then you're going to wait.
So we're going to wait. And we were on and off in an hour.
Wow.
Oh, so it was like half the time they predicted it.
Yeah, because that's a good 20-minute ride once you're in there and buckled
in. And it's the point
where
I think at nighttime they're starting to crawl down at time, so it might be very unpredictable. Probably more so, you're right, on the side of it's a shorter wait than it predicts.
We did that. We did the Rivers of Light VR1 because I have not seen the updated version of that.
And your thoughts?
I really wish I hadn't gone to California this summer. Or maybe I would have thought something different.
I understand, because, and I'm in the same boat. You see World of Color, and you go, what is this?
Why don't you see what Disney's capable of? I almost got up and walked out. If I didn't have my kids with me, I probably would have done it.
I completely understand.
They added animation to it. They did. They added Disney animation to it, which I think is fantastic.
Which is good. Yeah.
But
they removed the live characters, the live actors.
They did.
And that was, I think, that was a big, big difference also. Just that whole scene where they're doing the shadows on the sails of the boats as they're coming around. We're talking that show, right?
Now it's projections on the sails of the boats. Right.
Well, that's
now,
not even going to be there in November.
On the water is being projected onto the sail of the boat because you can't see what's being projected on the water.
Gotcha. That's not even going to be there at the park in November. I didn't see that on the schedule.
Really?
Yeah.
I didn't look.
I didn't see Times for it.
I did read something off topic, but we can go. Why not? Sure. They are, Lisa, having a New Year's Eve countdown at Animal Kingdom for the first time.
Yes. I just read this.
So historically, all of the parks have something special on New Year's Eve. Epcot, the Hollywood Studios, and Magic Kingdom. But Animal Kingdom never did in the past. But this year, for the first time, they're having an event at the Tree of Life.
Have you noticed the last 3 or 4 years they're taking this whole we're not supposed to do anything at night to disturb the animals further and further?
No fireworks. They did say that, but I don't know what that leaves. It sounds interesting.
This is really, I think it's less about
getting people out of the other parks is what it's all
that's
about.
Yeah, that to me is, that's what this is. This is less about Animal Kingdom and more about Magic Kingdom, Hollywood Studios, and Epcot getting them away from those.
And it said, hey, come and ride, come to Avatar.
And you know what they'll do? They'll do a animation on the tree if they'll do something for the countdown, because they have the animations now on both sides of the tree. So you'll even see it from the trail between Africa and Asia, along with being in front of it. And they could do pretty much a fireworks show or any type of celebration if they put the effort into making a new show for that, a new animation. I love that. Although I'm looking in November, I don't know if I'm going to be getting Animal Kingdom in the evening as much as I thought like the last couple trips this trip. I think it's going to be more along the lines of Epcot and Hollywood Studios. But we will see.
And Studios, have you been there at night recently as well, Lisa?
Yes.
In the summertime, it is just about impossible to watch both Fantasmic and the Star Wars fireworks.
Oh.
But as it gets dark earlier, they're moving Fantasmic up.
Yep.
So now it looks pretty doable. If Fantasmic's at 8 o'clock and Star Wars fireworks are at 9:30, you can get both those out in one night.
Okay.
And right now they're at 10.
At 10 for Star Wars fireworks.
However, for November 2nd through November 9th, they're both at 9 o'clock as of today. I was literally looking at the schedules today. Yep.
Come on.
And I was baffled about why they're doing it both at the same times again, since they had them staggered. I remember hearing that, too. I think it's a matter they want to get everybody out of Dodge, you know.
They're going to change that.
They might. They might change times right before we get down there again. They do that all the time.
They'll change. Oh, no. Hollywood Studios closes at 9.
Yeah, well, there you go.
That is early.
Yeah. So that's what I saw. But we'll see. And I tell you what, I would probably still see the fireworks over Fantasmic first off. If I went a second night, it would be the other one.
Fantasmic is another one of those things that Disneyland has spoiled me on. Lisa, I don't think that you got to see Fantasmic when you were out there. But
I did not.
Fantasmic 2.0, as they call it, is phenomenal. Wow. It's really good. I mean, just add projection mappings to the mountain. Right. That's really what it comes down into. Now you have all that extra stuff going on, and it's just, wow, an entire new addition to the show. Because that's a show where you're sitting and watching. So you can have projection mappings in addition to the water fountains and things like that. It's really done well at Disneyland.
Nice. And I'm sure it'll happen here, too.
I'm sure it will eventually.
That's just the need.
Well, that was all part of the we need something else to do at night before we close Fantasmic, because let's face it, for a few years, there wasn't all that much going on over there. There is now, but yeah.
Oh, no. Right. True. Okay, guys. So we're going to keep you updated on the Skyliner. We're all interested to see it get repaired, get it working again, and hopefully back in order by the time we get down there in November. Like I was saying, I had planned to use a whole morning just to basically tool around on it, just to chill out, basically check out the sights, take a lot of pictures, a lot of video and stuff like that. So hopefully it's going to be up.
Yeah, she's coming in hot.
And I have to imagine that they'll get that back up and running as soon as humanly possible. Outside of that particular incident, it's been getting a lot of rave reviews and people have really liked it. And I will tell you, once it gets back up and running, I'll be back on it. I'm very excited about it. And all the concerns that we had about the Skyliner, people were calling them hot boxes and all these other things. It's a great way to get around. The views are amazing. The little tidbits, little trivia that you listen to.
Is there audio in the car the whole time, Lisa?
Not the whole time, but there are little, you know, ding, ding, ding. You know, you're entering Pop Century. Like, that's how I knew that the station was floating over at Pop and Art.
Oh, right. They say it on the announcement. Yep. Nice.
Very cool. So a little trivia along the way. I like that. And you know, we'd heard there are rumors out there that if the gondola is successful, this could be the first part of it, and it could get extended to other areas within Walt Disney World, like downtown or Springs or places like that. So
that'd be interesting.
Well, let's hope we get over these issues and we can fix it. But that's, you know, it gets back to the monorail, which is too expensive for them to extend. It was too expensive. The buses were causing traffic. There's lots of things happening. What's a system that we can implement with minimal disruption to things happening? It turned out to be the gondola system functioning to service these handful of hotels to alleviate some bus traffic. If that's successful, this could easily be extended to Animal Kingdom or Springs. And those are all rumors, but it'll be interesting to see what happens.
Oh, and sure. I will tell you, on the morning of the opening, there were at least 50 people there, you know, not your generic cast members but people in shirts and ties and suits. They were there waiting, wanting, looking for feedback and excited about it opening up. And then I also heard when it crashed, when there was a slowdown, when there was an issue, that there were lots of people responding immediately. They'll get this fixed. They'll get it up and running.
Although, absolutely, yeah.
And it will be something that it'll be its own attraction. It'll be something very exciting to enjoy and experience with the family.
Right. And they have the monorail to use as their guide. I mean, based on all the merchandise we have out there now, they're taking the gamble that it will be as popular as the monorail, which I don't think that's going to be a problem. So
I can't wait to get some of that merchandise. I really think it looks cool.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. So the merchandise, you can get it over at Pop Century. You can get it at Hollywood Studios. You can get it at Caribbean Beach.
Yeah, pretty much all the stops on this, right?
Yep. And then you'll see little trinkets. You can see at the International Gateway, you can see there is some merchandise there. I know Angela's been looking for specific pins. We haven't been able to find them, but we did find, you know, socks. They're starting to float some things in other areas where they didn't normally have them. And the t-shirts, they have pass holder only merchandise for this.
Nice.
Oh, I did see some of those. Right. They were pretty cool.
The Christmas ornaments are really cool. We got an inaugural pin from the first day, from the grand opening. So that was really neat. There's a lot of great stuff.
Very nice.
Another way to spend your money.
Always.
Can't monetize it, then why put it in?
Exactly. That's how they're going to fund the leg to Springs.
Well, it's the literal store at the end of the attraction. They have it at every stop. Okay, guys. So I tell you what do you think? Have you been on the Skyliner yet? Can you not wait to get onto it, or are you still a little apprehensive? I heard a rumor that Jimmy was still a little kind of scared about getting on it, but we'll have to see what happens with that. send us an email. Let us know what you think. And speaking of, Jimmy, how can they get in touch with the show?
Look, he just zipped in on a zip line.
You can email us at questions@thedisneynerdspodcast.com and email us individually at ed@thedisneynerdspodcast.com, jimmy@thedisneynerdspodcast.com, etc. You can send us a message on Facebook to the page, The Disney Nerds Podcast. Join our group, Disney Nerds, Instagram at the Disney Nerds Podcast and Twitter at the Disney Nerds. Make sure to check out the website, www.thedisneynerdspodcast.com, and watch the live stream every Tuesday night at 9 o'clock Walt Disney World time.
Okay, guys. Well, that's it for show number 310 of the Disney Nerds Podcast. For Sam, Lisa, this is Ed, and we're the Disney Nerds, and we'll talk to you next week. Bye-bye.
So long, everybody.
Congaloosh.
If you would like to join our jamboree, there's a simple rule that's compulsory. Mortals pay a token fee. Rest in peace, the haunting's free. So hurry back, we would like your company.
Hurry back, hurry back.
That's horrible.
Okay, guys, well, thanks for listening, and we'll... Okay, hang on a second.
Oh, wait, there's Jimmy zipping from a zipline from a gondola. What's he saying?
Saying, where's my Carl's combo?
On the zipline. That's funny.